standing if you're coming to the book of Proverbs, please. Proverbs chapter 20. Proverbs chapter 20. Proverbs chapter number 12. Sometimes in our haste to perhaps read through our Bible, if you're doing it for the first time, I don't care if it takes you 5 years, get through it. That's a huge feat that it is. It's just big. The majority of Christians, no matter how long they've been saved, have never read their Bible through word for word through the whole Bible. The first time you do it, it's like, man, can't believe I did that. Then you do it again. And it's again. And you'll find out the next time that it's the things to do to show themselves to you. Next time you go through it, you do it again. So don't stop reading. You need to learn how to do that, okay? Proverbs chapter 12, verse number 1. Whoso loveth instruction loveth knowledge, but he that hateth reproof is brutish. So I wrote a word about that. Father, thank you for this time. Bless the dear people. Please use the word of God to speak to our hearts the way it was intended. And your spirit speaking to our spirit from the Spirit's book who authored it. We might be able to learn about Christ. Hope you have your outline. Reproof. Father, thank you. That is unpleasant. That is unpleasant. It's our nature does not like it. And if you're one of those people who go, oh, I love to be reproved, and that then, you know, with open reach, we may learn to value its results. Hopefully, we have as we learn. We realize that even there's a lot of value in that. Some people do that, but it will never be sweet to our taste. It's just, it's correction that we just do not like. And at the very best, when somebody reproves someone, it's like eating something bitter, like a bitter morsel. There's nothing pleasant about it as far as its taste. And so when we find out the difference between a wise man when it comes to reproof and a foolish man, it's not that one likes it and the other doesn't. Nobody likes reproof. If they're wise or not. The thing is, though, the fool on your outline casts to the side because it tastes bad. So I'm going to take this, I'm going to throw it to the side because it tastes bad. However, the wise man accepts the bad taste because it is precious and healthful. Not healthful, healthful. It's good for his health. So what happens is, a lot of times we take stuff, and I'm very finicky. But the fact of the matter is, if something doesn't taste right to me, if it doesn't smell right when I can't smell it, I'm not eating it. Say, hey, wonderful, I like lasagna because it's spelled lasagna, but I like that. I like terracotta. But anyway, the thing is, the fool casts it aside, and here's his reason. Here's his reason he takes reproof. Throws it aside because to him it's bitter. This is bitter, I don't like it. So he throws it aside. The wise man accepts the bad taste because it is precious and healthful, and somewhere along the line he's learned from it. So, first of all, what is reproof? You have it there on your outline, I believe. It blame expressed to one's face. Nobody likes it. Nobody likes being face to face and all I get. I don't know what you think you're doing. That was wrong, and you should. Nobody likes that. Even if they're at fault, we just don't like it. Our nature says reject it. It's bitter, it's harsh, I do not like it. So reproof means express to blame, expressed to one's face. It also means to simply be verbally straightened out face to face. Now, there's not a person in here that does that. Not a person in here does that. Now, let's look at the word brutish, it's a real old fashioned word. Brutish means, I'll give you four, but I'll take it too, because I think applies to insensible. Most people know what that means. It means gross. But because that's a term we use a lot today, you may not understand how that applies. How about this? Carnal. You know what carnal is? Carnal is a Christian thinking and acting like a lost person. They're not lost, but they're not spiritual. God has a term called carnal. When we talk about a brutish person, also means I'm taught. Taught by the Heavenly Father. So here we're finding out here that he hated reproof. A person does it because it's kind of brutish. In other words, they do. They haven't been taught the value of reproof. Or it is simply that they are carnal. In other words, they see no value in it because they're thinking like the world. And they don't see the spirituality or the value of the whole thing. It is brutish for a man to act merely according to his natural senses. Now, I told you before that I like feelings that God gave them to me. Feelings can be good, feelings can be bad. But we do have feelings. That's why you're best. That's why you try to do the whole, nobody can read me thing, everybody has feelings. The video that we watched. Sunday night, I was sat on the staff, we were talking about it afterward, and what they thought of things, and I wasn't seeing it. Others have seen it 4, 5, 6 times already. But something happened Sunday night when that came out. The feelings just not good. I had to get up and preach, I had to help those people. I tried my best to stop myself from reacting emotionally. Now, there are times when leadership or advisors are like, needs to be that you really do. Shut off the water once you can get something done. But there are other times that we've got too used to shutting things down and we should have let it go. So feelings can be good, feelings can be bad. So what happens here when a brutish man, when it talks about a brutish man, is a person who's carnal or a person who has not been taught or someone who acts like a brute. Somebody acts like a brute. When it comes to the health of our bodies, we're not so foolish. We're in America. We're one of the fattest nations in the world, and yet we have exercise machines, we have exercise places you can go to, we are constantly talking about diets and right foods and living healthy, and we're in terrible shape. We just are. And so what happens, though, when we talk about that, we see a lot of value in living healthy. Now, when we're little kids, I'll talk about me. When we're little kids, I could eat a whole box of anything sweet. To the point that makes me sick. So I can eat sweet stuff until it makes me sick. That's all I'm thinking. On the other hand here, I can reject the medicine which was specifically made to confront the illness that brought about the sickness because it didn't taste good. So the medicine was good for me, but because of the bitter taste, I'll reject it. However, the sweets are not good for me. I'll eat those by the box if it kills me. Okay, I'm focused on this. Think about what we do. My brother's boy, when he was a young teenager, his mother, Carlotta, made, I think it was like 2 dozen chocolate chip cookies fresh out of the oven, set them out there on the table. And he said, "Mom, can I have some chocolate chip cookies?" "Yes, we'll be back a little bit." They came and they were all gone. Every one of them was gone. And they said to him, "Mike, did you know this?" "Why?" She said, very wisely, "What if I had made 20 dozen?" And got sick. Now, the things that parents want to give their kids or that God wants to give us because of the sickness from us only wanting nice, sweet, easy life, God injects some medicine that's kind of bitter and kind of is offensive, and God said, "But this is good for your health. This will, on a spiritual level, this will help you get stronger." But we don't like that because our nature rejects reproof. As we naturally grow and naturally have understanding, our understanding is enlarged, we learn, hopefully, to accept sometimes bitter things that have to come from those who care about us. Now, listen, follow that thinking for a minute. We learn, okay, well, I'm going to do that. We learn to accept, hopefully, if not, you may be bigger, you may weigh more, but you're not growing up. Because reproof, try to reprove a teenager. Get in their face and just tell them what they did wrong. First thing you think about is, "I'm embarrassed, and this is, it shouldn't come out this way." We just don't check the right for that. We think that's what happened to your teenagers. Don't listen to that. Don't listen to that. Your boss gets on your work. First thing you do is go, "Why like that, this actually was sent out in the opening, was that face-to-face reproof, blame to your face. I'm not all that. We just want our nature says, I like it. You're white. That's a bitter taste. There's a bitter taste in that. I do not like it. But love is healthy medicine. You ever notice today we had white? He said, well, that could kill you. Well, you didn't want to get sick again, that's for sure. I guess that's where I get it now. People go, yes, preacher, you probably won't get sick again. Oh, no, no. I keep thinking that big paper, though. You know, I'm thinking, no, I get sick, that's all that happened, man. I'm not going there at all. And so what happens sometimes with reproof, it does have a better taste to it, and we really don't like it. But the mature person realizes the helpfulness, advantages that comes with that if we will accept it and not reject it simply because it's not sweet. If we would only be as wise concerning the things that hold higher value, our spiritual life, the cause of Christ, learning how to deal with other people, if what we do concerning our bodies, this doesn't taste good, that's what we good for. You know how we do. Well, they said it's good for you. It tastes so good, but they said there's a lot of vitamins in it, there's a lot of good in it. Okay, so we've learned. What about the nearest person? What about the nearest children? What about our example for others? If we would take the healthy things that our nation has constantly bombarded us with, is what's healthy, what's an advantage, and we don't even like some of it, honestly, come from who needs us? Asparagus? Is that the little old thing? Just the looks of it makes me want to throw up. Now, I can eat carrots, they're orange, but I can eat them. But why do you have to put them in a pot and warm them up to throw them in my mouth? I don't get that. And I'm assuming I already don't. And you said, well, have you ever tried it? Let me finish. I told you, if it's not a certain color, if I can't smell it or smell it, I'm not eating it. So, there's a lot of, I'm just ruining my illustration here, but anyway, I want you to go to 1 Kings chapter number 22. I think you have this on your outline. 1 Kings chapter number 22. 1 Kings chapter number 22, we're on verse number 8. Here we have a story of the king, Jehoshaphat, going to another king, you know his name, Ahab's not going to come in, and wondering if Jehoshaphat's wondering if he should go into partnership to fight some other kings. And so he's trying to figure all this out. So Jehoshaphat tells Ahab, do you have any prophets of the Lord around here? Maybe we ought to ask them. This is where we go. Let's cast some counsel. So he calls in, you know, 400 prophets. And all of them said, you better tell me what he wants to hear, because I'm not even one just from one. So they conjured up this story and said, oh, yeah, you're going to beat the power of these guys. Oh, yeah, we'll even make some horns. And as an illustration, he's shoving them right out of the country. And Jehoshaphat says, okay, do you have anybody else around here? They just got through with 400 prophets. I don't know what made him say this, but he says, anybody else in the country? Ahab says, there's one guy. His name's Micaiah. But watch what he says. If you look on your outline, here's what he says. Micaiah comes in and he says this. Micaiah says, oh, yeah, go ahead. You'll win. Don't worry about it. And Ahab says, don't lie to me. See, what happened was Micaiah told him what he wanted to hear. And Ahab says, you never tell me what I want to hear. So you're lying to me. So he gets upset and says, I told you. And here's what he says. Look down verse number 8, the latter part of that. Ahab says this, I hate him. And he says, what for? For he doth not prophesy good concerning me, but evil. You know what he was saying? He's saying, he just reproved me, and I hate this. I hate the guy getting in my face and telling me anything except what I want to hear. So what he was saying was, I'll only swallow sweet, good stuff I want to hear. And Micaiah said, sorry, I can't help you. But when I come back from the battlefield, he said, look, if you come back from the battlefield, I'm not a prophet. You ain't making it back. Well, it keeps a lesson from under the dungeon, but can you make it back? What he was simply saying was, he never gives me good, pleasant, sweet stuff that I want to eat. I don't want to hear anything but good stuff. It's not becoming our nation. Why does that preacher have to? Somebody told me recently, back about a month or so ago, I told him, it's a group to seem to reach people. Look, when you start living around, you're from the real house. I do. When I get close to the Lord, no matter what it is to chastise, I mean, I feel much better about myself. I don't feel good about myself when the Lord had just reproved me through His Word, and I go, I don't care. That's what Ahab did to Micaiah when he said, okay, yeah, you're winning. Don't you lie to me. You never say anything good about me, and now that you're saying good, I don't blame you. Okay, well, you're coming back from battle, you're going to die. See? He goes, why can't you just tell me nice, sweet stuff that I like to eat? This is what people come across the Bible. Grown men will eat flattery by the bowlful. We love to be flattered. By the way, you know flattery is not good. Not by definition. Flattery is playing upon the susceptibility of other people for your own purpose. No one should play. So the way you are flattering, he's playing you. So you get a preacher that goes, look, this way that guy can tell you. I'm not flattering you. So what happens here is simply this. Grown men will eat flattery because it's sweet. He says, well, see what he said to me? But we like to hear that stuff and refuse faithful instruction. You know why? So, but watch, if we respond to a prophet like the medicine that has a bitter taste, it's good for our health. The same thing, the Word of God is good for our spiritual growth and maturity. There are things that you want to run into that's like, oh, it kind of hurts. I know it does. Man, why didn't you just call out my name? But I didn't. Come on, we've all stayed in church long like this. I've watched some of you all but me say long like this. You can't do it. I was with Vicki yesterday in Boston all the time. And I'm thinking to myself, okay, why does that happen? This is God using His Word to reprove. Point, you can either say, if I take it, it'll be good for me. Or you can cross your arms and say, I'm going to try to just keep it going. I'm going to carry it from all those for myself. You can do that. And you can eat a whole plate full of chocolate chip cookies and chocolate soup. Because it's sweet. And then somebody says, you have belly aches. And you say, I don't like it. It's got a bad taste to it. A bad taste. You need to see the many Christians believe they can attain healthy spiritual perfection by simply dining on the acceptable delicacies that they choose and like, I'll get better, I'll get strong in the Lord. They're just picking and choosing the parts that I like. But it's just not. I have one of those that I want, two of those that I really like. There's going to be 12 of those. That's what we do. The Bible doesn't work that way. God is very honest and loving, even when He chastises, because He said, those who I chastise, I love. It's bitter. We don't like this kind of thing. So, we're talking about this scripture here in Proverbs chapter 12, verse number 1. It's simple here. We wonder, why do we have to swallow down? Sour, bitter, unpleasant, seemingly hurtful reproof. Why do we have to do that? I don't know. my life or something. What happens is because no advancement will be attained without particular painstaking trial, you will not be the first one that lives for the Lord and advances with Him without suffering. And in that suffering, the Lord many times will reprove us and stop us. Don't do that. I told you before, that's not one of my principles. That's not one of my commandments. That's not one of my examples. And yet we're deciding to eat all the cookies in the plate because somebody didn't say, don't eat all the cookies in the plate. Well, because the Lord didn't say I couldn't. So we decided to pick and choose what we wanted. And then we turned on the preachers and said, why can't you be nicer? Why can't you preach pleasant things? Why don't you preach things that are acceptable today? So you want a whole plate full of candy for dinner. And tell the truth, my son, my mom, and dad make us set to play. You can't do that. Somehow think we could be the Apostle Paul, but we want everything kind of dropped magically in our lap and turned out properly. Yeah, we want. We want to play the cookies. So we get sick. We'll eat sweet and jelly. All you gotta do is tell some point, you're really good. But not really. I mean, did you think it really was that good? I mean, no, no, we don't think it. I mean, when somebody goes like that, you can't do that. That's the wrong way to go about it. You were just going to be this. Somebody told me one time, talking about Joshua and how they used to kill everybody with the old devil. That's why God is what they're not doing. So you want peace without cost. You want America without price. You want to live for God and never have to suffer like even Jesus had to. So we're going about this all wrong. So here in Proverbs chapter 12, verse number 1, the reason we act this way a lot of times is that we're Brutus. Brutus means untaught. A brute or someone that's cruel. I do not see the advantage of having to swallow stuff like that. Who doesn't know? What do you see the advantage of? Not the same as what you need. That's reproof. Human nature hates reproof. Just hates reproof. So, you ready for exercise? Here's what you need to do. You know, in the New Testament, it says that I personally get under my body and I bring on this objection. Okay, here's another way to just say it. Human nature hates reproof. So, let grace, the grace of God, that's right. Take the bitter pill and shove it down your nature for it. If you don't think you can, what does it say? Because our nature hates reproof. So, what's our nature to do that? I know that's what it's like. Yes. Let grace. Take that bitter pill, which is good for you. That castor oil, that big staple rub, that whatever it is your hand will take when you were a kid. For instance, maybe in the coming years or something. Like my dad, I'll tell you, my dad would go, okay, Hannah, no, you put it in the tail like you, no. Stick your tongue out. Not all the way. I'm telling you, he put his throat all the way back. You punched it. He was already halfway down the time he took his fingers out of the mouth. Instead of going to bed, I won't hear it anymore. You see, you don't understand. In those days, you didn't run down the hospital. Oh, hurry, take the emergency room. And it happened. I ran a stick all the way down my throat, dropping off of that self-made bench, box, and an old piece of wood. And we were running out of that big stick in my mouth. Well, when little kids jump off something, they bend over. Here's my mom. Let me say it. I don't see anything, but you'll be all right, God. Come back outside. I don't care. life insurance, no insurance, you're not safe. You're going to go to the hospital. If there's no real blood or something's not broken, we're not poisoned. Get over it. And you wonder why I never go to the hospital. Why I never get sick. That kid has something to do with it. You ever notice a lot of people in third world countries, unless they get a disease or something, they're just tough for them. Oh, I got interjected. I was listening to the news. Guess what China has gone on to? The feminization of their children. Their boys are turning into effeminate little sissies. And on the news, they specifically said, we're putting a stop to it because they're becoming soft. They're becoming feminine. They're becoming girlish acting, and we're going to put a stop to it. You should have heard the people in America whining about that. So let me get this right. China, which we don't like, that makes everything we use, said something has dawned on us, something that Pastor Bell has been talking about for years. So now I have credibility because the news backs me up. The feminization of young men is covering this world. If we had the wisdom and energy to take the reproof that comes our way, if we had the energy, if we had the maturity, if we simply would take that reproof that is needed and care less about praise, honestly, it's like this. The preacher, it's been a while since you said they've done a good job. That's if I walk out of there one time because every time you turn around and you find my son, doing something wrong. He's always doing something wrong. Yay! Hey, you're a good boy. You still did things wrong, but you no, that don't work. It doesn't work. We have decided maybe if they're slow and they're lazy and they won't work, maybe if we give them money, that would be incentive to help them realize what they're doing wrong. This won't work. You stay quiet on the what happens here? Some reproof comes directly from God by providence and also by His word. Right? And believe it or not, that's probably the easier reproof to accept. You know what we don't like? David thought this way. Let me help you understand something. David found that a terrible rebuke was coming his way from men. It's coming his way. What David said was he pleaded that he might find himself in the hand of God instead of men. Men would be pretty cool. And we just kind of said, well, God knows what to do. So David said, let me prove this point. A rebuke is coming my way. I would rather fall into the hands of God and let Him figure it out for me instead of finding out what man has in store for me. Sometimes taking a rebuke from another man can be an awful hard thing. And think about the last time somebody face to face told you you were wrong and don't do it again. You would think, yes, I like that. Oh, I like people being honest with you. I always like people who say, I don't think I'll tell you the truth, be honest. No, you don't. No, you don't. If I was ugly face honest with you, I would embarrass you every time you turn around. What we mean is, I think I should be honest with other people. But if I've done something wrong or I really messed up, I don't know how much they'd be, and you tell me how to make it. So let's just stop being honest with everybody. So let's be honest with you. No, you don't. We don't like reproof. We don't like people. You know something? We don't like it. Even if it's true, we don't like it. You know, she's kind of pretty. We'd rather take that. Even if the other's actually true. So instead of taking it, there's going to be something I can do. And adjusting yourself to, we just reject the whole thing because it's not very pleasant tasting. So though all are ultimately disposed and given by God, it is. Reproof comes from person that's learned. I'm going to use the word now, so don't listen to me right here, this piece. Most of the recruits that meet us in our life come from our family. Our teenagers and many adults now, they want jobs without a boss every time they've done anything wrong. We want to go to the military where the guy is, look, if you're really tired and can't take it, just want a bright colored card and we'll let you take a break. When I say, look, they didn't even know my sister or my mom and they were talking about it when I went to the military. And here's what you're thinking. Well, I don't think that's necessary. Well, look at the military today. China, come on. China. We almost call them a third world country. China caught on and said, our little boys are becoming little girls. We've got to stop this. And America keeps saying, maybe we need to buy these bubble drinks. Did you see that? Did you go research it? Did you go research it? You didn't go research it? Oh, you can have a good life for you today. Problem is, they're serious. Anyway, even when recruit is given, listen, kindly and factually, our own love for self is against it. We just don't like people telling us when we've done wrong to our face. We don't like it. But the majority of reproof, to be honest with you, is mixed with anger. It comes across the line. Most of us don't know how to waste on what you do about that picture. Even though reproof may be applied by an enemy, oh, are you ready for this? I just told you about it, factual and helpful and coming from God and with a long tail, yes. What happens when it comes from an enemy? Somebody really has an enemy for you, meets you face to face. What do you do then? Well, I think we need to profit from it. Yeah, we came in here because of what you're doing here now. Example. I have a neighbor that I've offended. This is a big story. I have a neighbor that I've offended by something I said or done that he comes out yelling, screaming in my face. The whole neighborhood is listening at what he is saying to me and throwing around accusations and hard words. And what am I supposed to do? I throw hard words right back at him. That's a British action. My senses took over and I'm now reacting according to my senses. So we think the thing to do is get right back to the game. You see, what happens here is simply that we now remember Brutus is untaught or parlor. So when we react or act this way, it's not spiritually, we are rejecting the medicine that we probably need to take. So we're not saying. What happens is it is the stupid arts. Picking at all the pricks that he keeps rubbing against. So you know what he does in return? He picks all the more. And guess what happens? He gets stuck more, cut more, lacerated more, because he's reacting wrong. That's what the monks is doing. So we think, to settle it, I'll just swallow it and learn from it. No, we want to continue to kick back. We want to continue to. And another thing we're doing is hurting ourselves. We didn't learn a thing, it didn't call a thing, and all it did was hurt us even more. That's pretty bitter. Now, it is my business and to my interest to take all the good for myself out of something that somebody meant for me. We can't even understand what I just said. Have you ever gained maturity, knowledge, and understanding in a bad situation? Somebody say, best teacher in the world is hard times, you know. School of hard knocks. We say that, but when it actually happens, we don't like it. We wouldn't take that castle home, cast it to the side, and we'll take it to the front. Maybe one more cookie helps that all my stuff. Right? Maybe one more piece of cherry pie will help for a little bit. verse. An understanding man, a man who, the Bible says in 12:1, loves instruction. Realizes there's good in the rebuke for him to learn from. We're so busy concentrating on whether it was true or not, or we like it or not, we're not learning it. I can tell you right now, in my 50 years of Christianity, how long did it be? The first lesson I ever learned that hurt me in Christianity was somebody that told me off. And when I said, you did that on purpose, they said, yes, I did. I think Christians must be that way. Well, look where I'm at now. A lot of people do often talk about it. I had to learn. That's a bitter pill. That's a hard thing to swallow. How come people are so amazed in Christianity? Because they're human beings. And you can just buy people, soft people, nice people, loving people, pencil art people. I love that. And we think somehow we'll mature and learn like the Apostle Paul. No, Apostle Paul learned it through prison, learned it through walking alone, learned it through shipwreck, learned through beatings, learned through his friends leaving. That's the way the Apostle Paul. So before you get saved, oh, I wish I could travel with Paul. You really don't know what he's talking about. So what happens here? The most unmannerly, crude scold may have its filthy spit upon you. Don't tell. I don't care what you like. I had two people walk down the middle of our church and cuss me out. We don't want to get started. In this building, we had two big tiles and one big tile on this side, great big middle aisle, and a big middle aisle. Because we just moved from the storefront, we had a massive tile. And we had another section over here. And right during the announcements, I saw two people walk down the middle aisle and walk from my toilet, and they're cussing me out. And so I just said, okay, well, if somebody needs some help here, let's just go ahead and give me some help before they, and if somebody do something, so if somebody will stand up and try and bomb on somebody. What did people do? So later on, I asked myself, what? Why didn't you do something? Oh, man, I had to get from you back to church. Okay? We thought it was a skit. We don't put on skits when we cuss at the preacher. Most unmannerly, crude scold may have its filthy spit upon you. But listen, listen. But one that loveth instruction and loveth knowledge will find the preciousness in that. This one. And so it didn't come across right. This one. Get your name to it. Learn from it. It's like teenage girls, they have one best friend and they're connected to the kids. I mean, everywhere they go, like, you both got one single friend. And they're really, they say, well, they do. And then when they don't, the whole world is blind. My best friend likes another best friend. I think all of this way. Like, that's the way life is. Life was that way. You shouldn't have one best friend. Because if something happens, then you have no bestest friends. And I don't know how to make new ones because I want to have one in my life. We're not. So you're thinking to yourself, preacher, are you serious about what you're saying? You're telling me that by accepting sometimes bitter, rude, still, through words and reproof to my face that was not kind and wasn't right and didn't even seem to be helpful, it could be good for me. Absolutely. Absolutely. Put my point. Illustration. I've decided to take human sewage. And I'm going to collect it all in a great big tank. And I'm going to treat it in a certain way. And I'm going to make drinking water. That's where your tap water comes from. It's going to come from the well. It's called sewage treatment plants. So let me get this straight. To prove my illustration here, did I say something wrong? shake your hand, just make a statement, shake your hand. Oh, thank you. Okay. Well, I'm about to assume it's true. What do you think all this place goes to? Find the Ohio River? Okay, there's something that does, but anyway. Don't mix that sandwich with the truth. What we do is, let's be careful. The process of understanding is very difficult. But it's skillfully performed by those who know what's on the wrong part of our continuum. We get sidetracked so often. It really does produce a large return. We can actually get something good, something to follow, if we follow the right procedures and perform the instruction the way we're supposed to. It's just that our nature says better us. Simeon was one day running across the top of the ranch while David and his men were down here leaving the country. You know why David and his men were in the country? Because one of David's sons ran away from his kingdom. So instead of David staying and fighting, he said, "I'm going to go fight." Then he led the hair of David's heart was heavy. He's leaving his kingdom. One's voice to his kingdom. Leaving a lot of people that had left behind him with what his future was going to be. So he's walking out of this knucklehead. Simeon is running along the path, accusing him of stealing the kingdom and not doing what's right. He's calling him names and going on. Now, here's what our brutish senses would cause most of us to do. David had one of his mighty men, one of his mighty men with him. One of them spoke up and said this to David. Do we go up and take him for sale? Not to do that with him. Does anybody remember? Accusing David. And one of his men said, "I can go make this right. I'll cut off his head." David recognized his heavenly father had valuable instruction in this for him. What? Valuable instruction? Nothing that he's saying is right. The way he's going about it is all wrong. He's trying to embarrass me in front of all of my men. An open reproof or rebuke. David's son. David acted brutish, untrained, untaught. He had never heard anything. He had turned his mighty man loose and had begun to act. He had begun to learn anything. Because it was a bigger pill to swallow, really wasn't able to admit that. David was not concentrating on the falsehood or the embarrassment that the reprover was casting at him. David wasn't even thinking. Pretty much. occupying himself with the truth that was in it. Just because it came in a way that maybe wasn't fashionable, came in a way that maybe wasn't palatable, David said, and we just take the medicine, we just take it and toss it to the side as though no good, that will not help me at all. Just like this. So the greatest lesson I've ever learned is being the purpose for the medication. Attack. Embarrassment. Coming from someone that was in my face. There's a reason why God went back down and taken me through many episodes of forgiving that I didn't agree with. Because my decision to trust you to begin with. There's a fellow in the church that I used to attend, and his girls were in my interview. They had been in our church for some time, and I thought we were good friends, and I didn't know something. One day, the preacher was preaching on forgiveness. I couldn't take it. I just cannot take it. And I thought, this is what you're always doing. So I went up to him, called him by name, stuck it on my hand. I said, can I talk to you? Sure. I said, I don't want this room. I really don't want this room. There's something to happen. I don't want to do this. I'm just asking. I mean, honest to God, I said, if I were to put my heart out to God, I can't go on this way. I stuck my hand out. I said, whatever it is, I'm sorry. You know what's like? Oh, yeah, I just want to put my mind on it. How about this one? But I didn't do anything wrong. What if I apologize? Isn't that like a lying? I'm not asking you to admit to something I didn't do. I must admit the relationship is wrong, and that's what you need to apologize for. Yes, I'm personally. We go other places, but we wouldn't go home for school. No way. These are things you have to learn. Christmas. Understanding and instruction. A wise person, no matter how it comes to you, kindness, thankful, or someone assisting you make you hurt. You want to reject all that just because you're not successful. What valuableness. Received by somebody different than what you take as God wants you to learn something from your past. We're so worried about what people, let's not just take up for my family, they'll think I'm a sleeping. No, we already think that. But anyways, I'm not. I think that I can somebody hurt your kids or your wife, the first thing comes up to you, cry. And even if you go, what, you don't want to avenge your own family? Yeah, I would. And you go do something. You get thrown in jail and you help them. Did you learn anything? Crispy white meat from the freezer. And then they bring back to me. But in my younger days, the places was a lot of bad tasting, horrible, unfixed foods that I was forced to eat. Which to this point, I will give credit to my other sister. China's catching on. Thank you.